Good morning and welcome everybody to this Good Friday service. This day when we remember the Lord Jesus and his great sacrifice for us, for the salvation of his people, of people like ourselves. It's a great privilege to be able to share together in this celebration, this remembrance. And of course, we know that Good Friday is the culmination of so many promises of God that were given before so that they might be fulfilled in him. And that this is not the ultimate culmination this day, but there is another day coming, the great day of Jesus' resurrection, which we'll celebrate together in just a couple of days' time. And of course, all this points us to the final culminating day, the day of Jesus' great return to this world. And so we want to praise God together this morning and remember his great and precious promises to us. I want to read to you this morning, first of all, from Isaiah chapter 52, Isaiah 52 and verse 13, and reading on into chapter 53 to the end. This is God's word. See, my servant will prosper. He will be highly exalted. But many were amazed when they saw him. His face was so disfigured, he seemed hardly human. And from his appearance, one would scarcely know he was a man. And he will startle many nations. Kings will stand speechless in his presence, for they will see what they had not been told. They will understand what they had not heard about. Who has believed our message? To whom has the Lord revealed his powerful arm? My servant grew up in the Lord's presence, like a tender green shoot, like a root in dry ground. There was nothing beautiful or majestic about his appearance, nothing to attract us to him. He was despised and rejected, a man of sorrows, acquainted with deepest grief. We turned our backs on him and looked the other way. He was despised and we did not care. Yet it was our weaknesses he carried. It was our sorrows that weighed him down. And we thought his troubles were a punishment from God, a punishment for his own sins. But he was pierced for our rebellion, crushed for our sins. He was beaten so we could be whole. He was whipped so we could be healed. All of us, like sheep, have strayed away. We have left God's paths to follow our own. Yet the Lord laid on him the sins of us all. He was oppressed and treated harshly, yet he never said a word. He was led like a lamb to the slaughter, and as a sheep is silent before the shearers, he did not open his mouth. Unjustly condemned, he was led away. No one cared that he died without descendants, that his life was cut short in midstream. But he was struck down for the rebellion of my people. He had done no wrong and had never deceived anyone. But he was buried like a criminal. He was put in a rich man's grave. But it was the Lord's good plan to crush him and cause him grief. Yet when this life is made, his life is made an offering for sin, he will have many descendants. He will enjoy a long life, and the Lord's good plan will prosper in his hands. When he sees all that is accomplished by his anguish, he will be satisfied. And because of his experience, my righteous servant will make it possible for many to be counted righteous, for he will bear all their sins. I will give him the honors of a victorious soldier, and because he exposed himself to death, he was counted among the rebels. He bore the sins of many, and interceded for the rebels. So we have that great promise 700 years before the birth of the Lord Jesus, looking ahead to his sacrifice in our place. We were like sheep, says Isaiah, going astray, each of us turning to our own way. And yet the Lord laid on our Lord's, his great and glorious Son, all our sin, that we might be freed from that condemnation that justly convicts us. And so we praise God for this new day, and we ask him for his blessing. So let's now bow before God in prayer. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for this Good Friday, this day when we remember how great you are, when we remember that your promises are particular and true, and that your word is complete, that not one part of that word is void, and it will all return to you as you send it out for the task that you want to accomplish. And so please, Lord God, hear our praise and our thanksgiving. Yes, it is a day when we remember with sorrow in so many ways what our world has done and is doing in regard to turning their back on you. As we've already read, that was promised through Isaiah as well, that that's what was going to happen. And yet, Lord God, you in your mercy have drawn us near. So please lift us up with thankfulness. Give us praise and honour for you this day and every day, we ask. For we pray now and seek your face and your help in this time together. For we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. We're going to sing together of the Lord Jesus, the man of sorrows, the one whose sacred head is surrounded by that crown of thorns, and yet was doing so that we might be renewed and made near to God. Let's sing together to God's praise.
Oh,
important it is that we know that the Lord will not forget his love for us, that he will never, ever leave or forsake those who are trusting in his Son. It's a great and a precious thing to remember. We're going to come again before God in prayer now, so let's bow and let's pray. We give you thanks, we give you praise, Lord God, and we want to confess that we have great need of you. We have need of you every moment of every day, every hour, Lord God. There is not a time when we aren't in need. And we praise you, we thank you, that that need has been met in your Son, our Lord Jesus. There's no one greater or more gracious, Heavenly Father, than the gift that is found in your Son. He is the one who has poured out your Spirit so that we might be given newness of life. That on this day when we remember, this day when solemn things are brought to our mind, that we are doing so with joy and with peace and with trust in believing. And so we pray, O Heavenly Father, bless and strengthen us to hear your word and to take it to be our very own, so that we might give you all the praise and the glory that is your due. And so, Lord God, please hear our prayer and be with us now. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, Diane's going to come and read for us from Matthew chapter 21, verses 33 to 46. If you have that there, Matthew chapter 21, please open your Bibles to that section and pick it up at verse 33 and reading to verse 46.
Now listen to another story. A certain landowner planted a vineyard, built a wall around it, dug a pit for pressing out the grape juice, and built a lookout tower. Then he leased the vineyard to the tenant farmers and moved to another country. At the time of the grape harvest, he sent his servants to collect his share of the crop. But the farmers grabbed his servants, beat one, killed one, and stoned another. So the landowner sent a large group of his servants to collect for him, but the results were the same. Finally, the owner sent his son, thinking, "Surely they will respect my son." But when the tenant farmers saw his son coming, they said to one another, "Here comes the heir to the estate. Come on, let's kill him and get the estate for ourselves." So they grabbed him, dragged him out of the vineyard, and murdered him. When the owner of the vineyard returns, Jesus asked, "What do you think he will do to those farmers?" The religious leaders replied, "He'll put the wicked man to a horrible death and lease the vineyard to others, who will give him his share of the crop after each harvest." Then Jesus asked them, "Didn't you ever read this in the scriptures? The stone that the builders rejected has now become the cornerstone. This is the Lord's doing, and it is wonderful to see. I tell you, the kingdom of God will be taken away from you and given to a nation that will produce the proper fruit. Anyone who stumbles over that stone will be broken to pieces, and it will crush anyone it falls on." When the leading priests and Pharisees heard this parable, they realized he was telling the story against them. They were the wicked farmers. They wanted to arrest him, but they were afraid of the crowds who considered Jesus to be a prophet.
So we give thanks for God's word and praise him that this day we remember how that one would come who was spoken of by Isaiah as the man of sorrows, spoken of in the Psalms, as we've just read here, related in Matthew's gospel, the one who would be the stone that many would reject, and yet a stone that many also would rejoice in and sing the praise of. And we're going to do that again just now. We're going to sing the praise of the one who died, our Lord Jesus. And so we'll turn and sing right now. as you can see from the slide that's up now and what you've already heard, we're looking at Matthew chapter 21 today, and that's parable, that story of the Lord Jesus from verse 33 through to verse 46. So please have your Bibles open there at that section. Let's pray as we ask God to help us to know and understand his word. Lord God, please be with us now in this time of looking at your word. May it be that we see that the worst possible news that can come to us can also be taken away through the greatest possible news that we can ever hear, the best ever news of Jesus bringing forgiveness of our sins. And so please hear us now. Direct us in your word, we pray, for the sake of the Lord Jesus. It's in his name that we ask all these things. Amen. The worst possible news isn't a phrase you want to hear. No matter where it comes from, the doctor, a family member, a friend, perhaps the police knocking on your door, bad news is never good. The worst possible news is the last thing you want to get, isn't it? Precisely because it is the worst. Very often people have thought that the term Good Friday is a strange one, since it's a day that brings the worst possible news. Jesus, the innocent one, the Son of God, was killed. He's put to death on a Roman instrument of torture. Men rejoicing, men reviling over his destruction. Sounds like terrible news. Yet in the reading from Matthew 21 that we've heard today, we find out that there's far worse news for someone to hear than the death of Christ. What's that? What's far worse news? Well, it's just this. The worst news is the rejection of the one who died in the place of sinners, Jesus. The worst possible news we can receive by far is that we've rejected this and turned away. That we've heard the word of the Lord about the real purpose of Good Friday, heard what makes today good for people who love the Lord and trust in him, and we've turned a deaf ear to it. We've given God the cold shoulder, or worse, we've hated him and his message of rescue from sin. That's worse news, to hear all that Jesus has done and to turn from it. Well, the powerful, the urgent, the two-pronged takeout from this morning, this Good Friday then, is to take seriously what God who saves, the rock who is higher than us, what he says. And if we haven't done that, if we haven't already taken seriously what he says, to make sure that we do, finding peace and joy and trust in believing that Jesus didn't just die, but that he died in your place and in mine. In this story, this parable told by Jesus about a landowner and some tenant farmers, God the Father is represented by the landowner. And the farmers, the tenants, they are a picture of all who won't have a bar of the right, just and good rule of God in their lives. It's a kingdom shaped and a kingdom focused account. And it's not just any old kingdom that is in view, it is the kingdom of God. And we see this underscored for us in verse 43. Look at it with me, where we read in application of the punchline of the story, we're told how the kingdom of God will be taken away from you, says Jesus. The you being the Jewish unbelievers of the day who ultimately represent all who won't believe. Jesus says in verse 43, the kingdom of God will be taken away from you and given to a nation that will produce proper fruit. This other nation consists of those who will produce the proper fruit of faith. Faith in the Son and heir of the kingdom. And that includes, of course, every one of us who, rather than recoiling in horror on Good Friday, actually embrace the solemn significance and rejoice in the good news of sin being dealt its death blow. It's surely right then to call what we have here in Matthew 21 an Easter parable. It's an account that shows how, in God's great and perfect plan to save, the Son is crucial. It's right too, don't you reckon, to be willing to deeply consider how to respond to the worst possible news positively, to hear the worst news and then to positively respond. Well, let's go ahead now and dive right into what's well described here as an Easter parable. Please make sure you have your Bible open there. And this first section, of course, begins at verse 33. Well, it's a common enough scenario pictured here by Jesus. A landowner who's worked hard establishing his vineyard, taking tender care of it, building the wall, building the wine press, putting the watchtower in. He's taken tender care of this vineyard, and now he wants to go on an extended break. So what does he do? He leases it out, this vineyard, to the tenants. There's nothing very dramatic thus far. But when it comes time for the harvest, and a share of the crop is to be collected, that's where the rot starts to set in. First of all, the servants of the owner, one group and then a larger group, they are sent and they are treated shamefully by the tenants, by the farmers. One of these servants of the landowner is even killed. And the motivation is obviously to renege on the agreement, and ultimately to mount a hostile takeover. The awful degree of their plan is put into action when the owner's son, having sent the two groups of servants, the owner thinks, I'll send my son. The farmer's plan is put into action when the owner's son comes and he is disrespected. He is plotted against. He is murdered. You can imagine the outrage building up as Jesus' hearers are drawn into demanding justice. Justice needed to be done for the wrongs that these tenant farmers had undertaken. Never suspecting those hearers as Jesus spoke to them, never suspecting that they were the target of the story. But that's precisely the Lord's purpose. So you see here, have a look from verse 33, what's pictured in the story of the landowner and the tenants is God's right and loving rulership being cast aside, being thrown off, as Psalm 2 puts it. His gracious provision swept away as his son is put to death. Just a couple of verses to refresh our memory of what's being said here. Look at it, verse 34. At the time of the great harvest, he sent his servants to collect his share of the crop. The farmers grabbed the servants, they beat one, they killed one, they stoned another. The landowner sent a large group of his servants to collect for him, but the results were the same. Verse 37, finally the owners sent his son, thinking, surely they will respect my son. But, listen to this, when the tenant farmers saw his son coming, they said to one another, here comes the heir of the estate. Come on, let's kill him and get the estate for ourselves. So they grabbed him, dragged him out of the vineyard, and murdered him. Justice needed to prevail for that. Those who heard Jesus speaking that day knew it. We feel it and we know it as well. But there's a bigger picture going on here. As with each of the parables Jesus told, this one is not simply a nice little moral tale without any definite point. No, it's told by him, this story, in order to advance the teaching of why he came and what it means to have ears to hear, what it means to have hearts that respond with preparedness to love the Father, to love the Son, and not to reject them. That's why we can and we should grab hold of the truth that Jesus' question about what should happen to the farmers, we should see and understand that that question is designed to bring conviction about injustice, as well as to highlight how mercy triumphs over judgment. Have a look, verse 40. When the owner of the vineyard returns, Jesus asked, what do you think he will do to those farmers? The religious leaders replied, "He will put the wicked men to a horrible death and lease the vineyard to others who will give him his share of the crop after each harvest." Yes, we need to be convinced that justice must prevail, but also to see how mercy triumphs over judgment. The landowner doesn't simply say, "Well, I'm never going to have another tenant." He says, "I will lease that tenant out, lease the vineyard out to other tenants who will produce the right fruit." What we should be readily getting out of this story is the same basic point the first hearers did. Namely, that justice is something that always needs to be upheld. It's not a fable that can mean whatever you want it to. On a more extensive level, though, we should be prepared, you and I, to go further than those original hearers did and positively appreciate that in a telling example of how God's messengers and ultimately God's Son were treated, Jesus makes it plain that God's justice is both warranted and deserved for those who reject his rule, but it is also a wonderful thing that God's justice, warranted and deserved, is triumphed over by mercy through the sacrifice of the Son. So we've seen that this story is an Easter parable. It has far-reaching impact right across the generations and down to us today. At the heart of what we need to be sure about regarding the Son in the story is how he's a picture of another Son. The Son in the story is a picture of another Son. He is the Son, this other one, who is crucial. For lots of people, reading the Bible is treated as an occasional, a sort of academic exercise. It's something to be engaged in at particular times of the year, like Easter or Christmas maybe, but not really taken seriously as God's word or to be accepted as the answer to how to live for him. Being content to do that with any passage of the scriptures, let alone this one, would be a very superficial and unwise thing to do. So instead, let's dig deeply here into this story about one son who points us to another son, the crucial one. Let's pay attention to how God's challenge to us, you and me, is whether or not we have read his word about building our life and our hope for eternity on the despised and rejected one, and whether we've understood this word with wonder. Have a look, verse 42. After the religious leaders replied what should happen, Jesus asked them, "Didn't you ever read this in the scriptures?" Psalm 118 is where he quotes from. "The stone that the builders rejected has now become the cornerstone. This is the Lord's doing, and it is wonderful to see." See, this is what you and I need to do. To take up this challenge, to believe what we are reading for now and for eternity, and to believe with a true wonder and joy. This is what we need to do, to read, to mark, and to learn God's word to us. And then wonder with praise and with thanksgiving at how good God is to say to us, "Here's the way, walk in it." How good it is for us to see with wondering eyes the punchline of Jesus' story and to know and understand that this is the bottom line of the gospel message. Either we stand on the rock that is higher than us, or we trip over him, we fall, and we perish in our way. Verse 43. "I tell you, the kingdom of God," says our Lord Jesus, "will be taken away from you and given to a nation that will produce the proper fruit. Anyone who stumbles over that stone," the one that's rejected but that God has now made the cornerstone, "anyone who stumbles over that stone will be broken to pieces, and it, that stone, will crush anyone it falls on." Let's not be confused then or deluded into thinking that this message, well, it's for someone else. It's for us. It's for each and every one of us. Have you stopped to think, really think, And have you bowed your knees to this one who is despised and rejected by so many, and yet who is precious, the cornerstone that we can build upon? Have you bowed your knees to him as King and Saviour? For you should, you must, we must. Because God's Son, we find here, is at the very heart of God's kingdom. His kingdom both present, his kingdom coming. He, God's Son, the Lord Jesus, he is the stone who's crucial. And we either build on him by faith, or we stumble in rejection. You see, there's no middle ground between the two. Well, having come this far, there's only one thing left to think about, and that's just this. How do you respond? How will we respond to what we have read? Well, let's just pause for a moment and pray that God would help us to respond rightly and with trust and faith in his Son. Heavenly Father, we bow before you now, and we do ask that everyone who hears, all of us gathered in our homes, wherever we might be, that we might just now stop and recognize we're to respond with gracious faith that is a gift from you. Lord God, respond to the one who is true and glorious over all. Help us, we pray, to do that, to love, to serve and honor you, because our Lord Jesus has loved and served and honored us. We pray in his great and gracious name. Amen. How do you respond? That's the very end point of this parable, this story. How will we respond? Have a look at verse 45. When the leading priests and Pharisees heard this parable, they realized he, Jesus, was telling the story against them or about them. They were the wicked farmers. They, the religious leaders who heard that day, they wanted to arrest him, but they were afraid of the crowds who considered Jesus to be a prophet. They wanted to arrest him and ultimately to see him gotten rid of, not just to be put in jail, but to be killed. And yet it is all part of God's great plan. Yes, this is the big question. How do you respond? It's the question that eternity with or without the Lord Jesus hangs on. Do you realize that this Good Friday, perhaps in a way you might not have fully gotten hold of before, do you understand that we must respond positively to this worst possible news, that we are lawbreakers, that we are not those who are naturally able to relate to our God, who is our Heavenly Father, but that we can by his grace and his mercy? Have we understood that? See, here's the thing. The thing we need to address and to be clear about in regard to where we stand with the Lord. Matthew tells us plainly that the people listening to Jesus' parable that day, they came to realize that they were the farmers. They were convinced of the injustice that had been done to the landowner's son and servants. And yet they hated the incrimination that came to them. They did not respond positively to the fact that they were the farmers and fall down and say, "We are sorry," to the Lord. Instead, they wanted to see him arrested and done away with. See, that's the hard rub of the story here. Jesus' application of it to us as well. Have you understood that there's no doubt the point was brought home to those hearers, to us today, but the weight of the conviction was too much for them? And what's their response? Well, shoot the messenger. Get rid of him instead of repenting. Well, as appealing as it has been for so many, appealing and sadly compelling, writing off the messenger, thinking that will eliminate the message, it doesn't work. We are all incriminated, no matter what plan of avoidance we've come up with, no matter what excuse we might care to offer, no matter how much we might stick our fingers in our ears, close our eyes and sing la 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 till the cows come home, there's ultimately going to be no way round the question from God. How did you respond to my son? So this Good Friday, respond positively to him as the rock upon whom we can build our lives, As we realise the impact of self-incrimination, the question for us to face is, what will we do with Jesus? Refuse him by rejecting his word, or rejoice in him by accepting it? Please rejoice in him. Accept his word. That's the call of this passage. You know, our ideas about who knows best about us and how we ought to live, those ideas need to be changed. If we come to see that we are complicit in the arrest and the death of Jesus, then we also ought to see that we are able to be welcomed as well, that mercy triumphs over judgment, that we are able to be welcomed by the Father, who by rights should reject us as wicked people, as like those tenants who did not accept the landowner's rule. God draws us and calls us. And so we need to avoid the obvious conclusion that we can run from God and hide. Avoiding that, avoiding the fact that we are guilty before the Holy God by trying to do away with his message and messenger, that's foolish. But accepting his verdict, crying out for mercy to the Lord who forgives, well, that is wise. So what way will you go today and from this day forward? What way will you go today and from this day forward? Will you turn into the path of faith in the Son of God who loved us and gave himself for us, keeping on going in that path all your days? Or will you march to the beat of your own drum until you are finally crushed? God would have us not to be crushed, but rather to be drawn near. That's the message of Good Friday. That's the message of hope. That's the best ever news that we will come to see as the Lord Jesus is risen from the grave and we celebrate his resurrection. But it is not diminished by today. The very great and wonderful news can be ours as we take it to be our own. Please join me as we pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for all that you have done, all that you are continuing to do in the purposes of your Son and your plan of gracious and good redemption. On this Good Friday, we know that there is no place better to flee to than the rock who is higher than us, our Lord Jesus. He's the cornerstone, the one on whom we build, the one who holds all things together. And without him, our lives, our whole world would crumble and fall away. May it be, Lord God, that we don't stumble over him and fall and are crushed, but instead rejoice in him and are renewed every day. Please, O Father, refresh us in this message. Refresh us in the hope of the gospel. Refresh us in trusting you, we ask, all the days of our lives. And we would pray and ask for your blessing, your help and your strength in our world at this time, to be servants of yours and of the gospel, to be praying and committing our way to you, as well as we pray for those who are sick, those who are sorrowing, those cast adrift in uncertainty and panic. Lord God, please help each one to come to you. Take us and use us as instruments to communicate the word of your truth in every way we can, and to live out the glory of your gracious message in each of our lives. O Lord our God, hear our prayer. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. We're going to sing our final song this morning. It's based on Isaiah 53, speaking of Jesus as being the man of sorrows who triumphs. And we know that we can say, as we will sing in just a moment, hallelujah, what a Savior, man of sorrows.
What a name for the Son of God.
To remember the Lord Jesus and all that he's accomplished. This is what John writes to us, the Lord's people today, the message from the Lord Jesus. Don't be afraid. I am the first and the last. I am the living one. I died, but look, I am alive forever and ever, and I hold the keys of death and the grave. May God bless you in the rest of this Good Friday. And continue to rejoice in him, turn to him, and honour him in every way. We'll be back on Sunday morning, the same time, 9:30, for our Easter Sunday celebration, and the chat section of the program will remain open if you wish to be encouraging each other and talking through these great truths. That'll be open for just a little while. May God bless you all.